Well, very warm welcome to all of you at CQ's biannual conference, which they have been hosting for the past so many years. And it's a privilege for me to be a part of this mega event, which has been organized by CQ. And the reason for being of people who are here represent some of the biggest and the best names related to the ecosystem of the clean energy industry, be it from the financing world, be it from the developers world, be it equipment suppliers. So I would like to convey my sincere thanks to EQ for considering me worthy enough to be a part of this session and be a keynote speaker. And I would like to take this privilege and to throw some insights into the financing, because finance is something which I live day in, day out. So my talks and maybe my presentations may be more inclined towards finance. Personally speaking, I feel clean energy is one of the most simplest industries to execute and furthermore simpler to operate and maintain. And the advantages of a clean energy industry cannot be really, I would say, undervalued by any circumstances, because the kind of wrath which the global climate changes have been throwing in different geographies in the world, maybe by way of droughts, floods, cyclones, thunderstorms, significant rise in temperatures, depletion of potable water resources. So it's a no-brainer that this particular industry needs to be really focused upon, because apart from protecting the climate, there are also economic advantages for a country like India. Because we are a power-hungry nation, we are on the cusp of becoming a developed economy. The demand for power has been rising, will be rising with every passing day. So it's a no-brainer that this particular industry really needs to be taken to a different league altogether. And the government's ambition of having a 175 gigawatt footprint of clean energy by 2022 or maybe 2023 is definitely a very noble intention. But somehow I feel the entire ecosystem is not very conducive enough of late to really give a thrust or an impetus to this particular goal or milestone which the government has in mind. The demand which I am talking of the power which this country will be requiring in coming days, definitely I don't feel it should be left to the fossil fuels or the conventional fuels to really take it up on themselves to fill up that demand, because the price which the future generations are going to pay because of that will be way too high. So you look at it from any direction, from any perspective, clean energy industry is an industry which definitely needs to be promoted at any cost, and all the policies and guidelines and support from the various federal and the state governments have to be really conducive enough to really take this particular industry to a different level. This industry started off maybe in 2010 or something on a smaller scale with plant capacities of 5 gigawatt, 2 gigawatt, 10 gigawatt. But the actual point of inflection of the industry came in the period 2014 to 2017, where the growth has really been humongous. The size of plants have really scaled up like anything. We don't talk of anything less than 100, 200, 300 megawatt offering. The kind of tenders which are coming, they are also four-figure tenders minimum. And one thing which I've observed, the costs and the tariffs have been moving in tandem since 2010. When the costs of this particular industry, setting up this industry was not an easy task, because the costs were around 15 to 17 crores per megawatt. The tariffs were also around 15 to 17 per unit. Then 12 crores per megawatt, 12 rupees per unit. 8 crores per megawatt, 8 rupees per unit. But off late we have been seeing they have not been moving in parity. The kind of aggression which the developers have taken upon themselves in the bidding thing, that may take a toll on this industry maybe in the near future. The costs are hovering around 4 to 4.5 crores per megawatt, but the tariffs bid are around 2 to 2.5. So I really don't know what kind of calculations the developers have in mind, what is enticing them to really go all out on these kind of numbers, and it's really like it defies logic, because as I represent the developer side, so we really fail to really fathom that particular calculation or arrive at that calculation, which really induces the developers to quote these kind of tariffs when the costs are not really coming down commensurately. I have made a small presentation for everybody. We just go through it. A small perspective about Avaada. Avaada is virtually Western Energy. We have been in the industry since 2010. We had partnered with Western Energy and created a footprint of 1.2 gigawatt in a span of 5 years in the country, inclined more towards solar. Which we then monetized to Tata Power in 2016. Western Energy was managed under the leadership of Mr. Vineet Mittal and his wife, Ms. Indu Mittal. And in May 17, we separated formally from the Western group and we rechristened ourselves as Avaada. And we continue our journey in the same space, which is clean energy. About renewable energy sector, this is a small cartoon of what I just said. The industrialists, though it's very critical, economic development is also very critical, industrialization is also very critical, but maybe knowingly or unknowingly, in the urge for development, we are really ignoring what is happening to planet Earth. So, you may say, well, I don't care even if you get overcooked, but I would like to make my gains or my returns today only. So I would like to consume all the scarce resources on day zero. That is the urge, because the entire world now seems to be in a valuation game. That quarter on quarter performance pressures and all, they really led to a different kind of scenario globally. This is one more thing we crib every now and then about weather. But the kid has that perspective in the hindsight. You are complaining about the weather, but see what you have done. It's a question of introspection for all of us. So as I said, clean energy is an industry which can really take care of these kind of issues, because apart from protecting climate, it also results in economic development. Because it's the cleanest form of power, and power will really play a very important catalyst in economic development of any country, especially a country like India, which really wants to move from a developing economy to a developed economy. Three data points here, which I would like to bring. Why I said the demand for power will be humongous. It's because the per capita consumption of power in India is pathetic as on date. In spite of the fact that we may be having a decent GDP growth rate and things like that, but because the entire wealth is concentrated in a very few hands, so the kind of per capita consumption of power has been really low. If you see US, it is 11x of India, China is 4x, the world average is 2.3x of whatever India consumes on a per capita basis. So, the potential for generating power through clean energy sources is shown in the chart below, where solar and wind resources which have remained largely untapped, because India is blessed with a very sunny climate, almost 330 days of sunny days in a year on an average, and very good destinations from a wind perspective. So the kind of potential which we have from the clean energy industry is humongous, and we can definitely achieve our power requirements through this particular industry if at all the entire ecosystem works in a very conducive manner. Because apart from development, as I would like to reiterate, it also helps in the climate change perspective. As on date, the majority requirement of power is met by thermal industry. It's almost 63%, and a very minuscule percentage is through the clean energy industry. There again, if you take the CUF percentage, the actual generation is way too low. It's around 20-25% CUF, solar and wind. So still there is a long way to go as far as power is concerned. These are some, maybe a data overkill, but I'd like to highlight a few points out of this. Earlier, when the clean energy industry was in nascent stages, it was driven more by fiscal and tax incentives. Like every guy under the sun wanted to set up a wind turbine because of the tax benefits he used to get. It was not from an economic scale perspective or maybe a meeting of power requirement for economic development perspective. It was more driven by fiscal and tax incentives, which is not the case now. The kind of tenders and the capacities which are being set up by the developers is really very, very big. And the incentive is definitely to make money apart from contributing to the climate. The entry of many large corporates, maybe like Aditya Birla, Hero, Adani, Startas, that has really become a game changer, because these large diversified corporates have also seen value in this particular industry. And they also understand, because to reach a 175 gigawatt footprint, it means there is action for everybody to participate. A lot of pie is left on the table for everybody to come and set up plants and make money in the process. The debt requirement, I'd like to zero down on the financing aspect now. The debt requirement for a clean energy play to achieve at 175 gigawatt is humongous. If you assume 4 crores per megawatt cost of setting up a power plant and a debt equity ratio of 75-25, what you need is almost 216,000 crores of debt funding. So as Mr. Ravi touched upon that particular fact, yes, funding of late has become difficult, which I think every developer in the industry is facing as on date. In spite of the fact that this particular industry, as I said, is one of the simplest industries to operate and to maintain, and the kind of benefits which it will be giving to the entire economy as a whole. What are the challenges in a clean energy funding? The experience may be slightly biased, maybe from our perspective. This is our viewpoint. We have been in the thick of things in the industry for the last 6-7 years. So some of the experiences may be quite unique to us, maybe because I have been to many banks seeking funding for the energy industry, and most of the banks have been telling us that we do funding on a selective basis. So I have really not been able to gather what that selective means, whether it's an objective parameter or a subjective parameter. But we have definitely faced issues in funding from PSU banks of late, which have been virtually absent from the scenario for the last 2 years almost, for various reasons. So PSU banks and bond market may be doing some dilly-dallying here and there, but definitely it's not that pervasive. PSU banks are completely absent from the scene for the last 2 years. I don't see them lending to the clean energy industry. Maybe to big names like Adani's and all, they may be definitely giving funding. But we as developers, as Wellspun Energy, we have definitely not been able to have a taste of funding from them for the last 2 years. Private banks, they have really been supportive of us per se, whether it was our Western Energy journey or now it is the Avaada journey. All our financial closures have happened very seamlessly courtesy the private sector banks. But even for the last 6 months or so, because of whatever is happening in the ecosystem, maybe by way of crisis in the NBFC sector, or Yes Bank kind of issues, these banks have also taken a slight backseat of it. Specialized NBFCs are the only ones which have been active throughout. And when I say specialized NBFCs, I mean the institutions based out of Delhi, like PFC, REC, IREDA. They have been really supportive of this industry, and I think almost every developer flocks to these guys based out of Delhi and get the financial project done. bank credit to infrastructure. Infrastructure, the name itself, I think, is a touch me not for banks as of now. Because whatever mess they are in as on today, the majority contributor may be reasons intrinsic to the bank's decision making or maybe on the borrower side has led to them to be quite wary about infrastructure. So the bank lending to infrastructure is significantly reduced. It's just 10.8% growth in the infra funding which the banks had achieved in the year FY18, which is virtually a 14-15 number we have come back to. What we were looking upon was a significant rise in the funding to infra, because infra is something which plays a very important catalyst role in the economic development of any country, because if you don't have an infrastructure, the other things definitely fall flat. So infra funding is the need of the hour, but per se, the kind of situations with the banks are in play, that particular door is virtually closed. Again, one more source of funding for the clean energy. We are glad to inform Raviji that we were blessed enough to get funding from Aditya Birla when we were invested in energy. They had underwritten two or three of our projects. So, definitely, they were still in the game. Maybe it was because of their conviction in Western Energy, the kind of executions we had done. But we were definitely blessed enough to be funded by people like HDFC Bank, Aditya Birla, IndusInd Bank, who are supposed to be perceived to be very conservative, but they had underwritten checks for us. But because of ILFS and DHFL things, which I would say the reactions may be knee-jerk at some points of time, but definitely, that has led to a pushback even from the NBFC side. So, they may be keen to lend, but the cost of funds from NBFCs has really shot up like anything. And the top lines which are driving the profit and loss accounts of developers today, or see the numbers which they have bid, these kind of interest costs will definitely eat into the entire profitability, whatever they have been making. Whatever little was left on the table because of those kind of tariffs. The absence of PSU banks has also had one more impact. Like earlier, the NBFCs and big private sector banks, they were ready to do an entire underwriting of the projects because they were assured of a downselling market. There were PSU banks available to whom they could have gone and downsold their entire portfolio and freed up their capital for further underwriting of checks for developers. But because of the absence of NBFCs, PSU banks, the universe for downselling has really narrowed down or shrunk considerably. So that is one more deterrent which is not allowing private banks and NBFCs to underwrite projects even if they want to. Because they are really not sure whether they will be able to really downsell that particular portfolio to PSU banks, free up their capital, and go ahead for the journey process. The table on the left hand side is a very simple table, but it really highlights that this industry is virtually risk free compared to a particular manufacturing industry or maybe a thermal power industry or a conventional fuel industry. If you see the various parameters which a particular lender may go forward to for funding, this industry takes right in every box, maybe except land acquisition, because the land requirement is humongous, and in a country like India, where every state has a very peculiar regulation related to land, land itself becomes a very peculiar asset class. So, only apart from the land requirement, otherwise this particular industry is a no-brainer from a funding perspective and the kind of contributions it does to the global warming aspect which we are all facing today in some form or other. Possible solutions to availability of finance for the clean energy industry. One is, there is a small cap of 15 crores which has been allowed by RBI and priority sector lending to highly misplaced in today's context, because of the kind of tenders, the size of tenders, the humongous amounts of funds required, that really necessitates this particular cap should be removed and renewable energy should be placed in a priority sector lending. And policy related issues, there have been many flip-flops from the government side, whether the federal or the state. So as I said earlier, the ecosystem is not conducive enough to really ensure that 175 gigawatt is achieved. Power sector consumes the entire exposure limits of the banks. So clean energy really fails to make a dent into the lending from the banks, because the entire thing has been written up either by the exposures to the DISCOMs or maybe to the conventional power sector. So there should be a separate sub-limit for the clean energy sector under the power sector limit, so that banks can allocate some funds and lend to these kind of projects. The standard reason from every banker is our power limit sector is virtually joke. One more is the spoil sport role which DISCOMs have been playing off late. So I think there should be a penalty on DISCOMs for delayed payments, because they generally go scot-free. I have heard in some cases, in spite of a 6-7 month delay, when they make payment to you, they ask for cash discount. So that's highly ironical. First of all, you're delaying payments, you are really impacting the working capital cycle of the developer, and then you have the audacity to ask for cash discount. So these kinds of provisions and some teeth in the policies which really deter the DISCOMs to act spoil sport from developers' perspective really make a lot of difference in ensuring the top lines are achieved and the debt servicings are not impacted. As on date, there is no case of a bad asset in the clean energy industry per se from developer side, but I really don't know if these things continue, whether we are bound to be facing these kind of situations which thermal has faced. So let's see, only time will say.